Welcome to Season 4 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Commissioner of Health in Baltimore City. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to current topics in public health through engaging interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, Stephanie Desmon talks to Carl Dieffenbach, director of the Division of AIDS at the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases. They discuss the development of oral antiviral medication, how soon it could be before we can take these COVID-19 pills, and how they may change the trajectory of the pandemic. Let's listen.
Carl Dieffenbach, thanks so much for joining me.
Pleasure to be with you today.
Today, the topic is, for the most part, oral antivirals and how they are being developed and what they could mean for the COVID pandemic as we know it. So could you start with telling us what is under development and how they work?
Yeah, so think about coronavirus disease and what we have been through is we've seen the disease pattern where a number of people convalesce very easily and others get sick and progress. So the goal of the use of these oral antibiotic or oral antivirals is to prevent people from getting sicker so they can rehabilitate faster. So that's basically the idea. So it's like any other drug. You get an infection, you take the drug, you get better, you move on. And that's the goal. The history on antivirals, we've had a lot of success in HIV, in flu, and hepatitis C. So we're building these programs on the backbone of the success we've had with other antivirals. So if you think about flu, we see that we have to take the drug very fast after initial infection. That's the same principle here. These people who are relatively newly infected with coronavirus, or newly symptomatic, have to get tested and take the drugs and take them within 3 to 5 days of initiating symptoms. So the drugs we have in development right now target the virus in two different places. We have drugs that target the polymerase, which is the enzyme that the virus uses to make its nucleic acid, make its RNA, and a protease inhibitor that prevents the virus from processing or chopping up a polyprotein into its component parts. And it gums up the works, as they say, and the virus dies. So those are the two targets we have that are currently in development now. And the first that moved along was Molnupiravir, which reported out its findings from Merck this week.
How soon could we see that approved?
Well, we won't see it. So let's talk about approval. So like the vaccines, we're going to go first through probably an emergency use authorization process where the drugs and the drugs as opposed to the vaccines will be approved for an indication for certain populations. And that should occur by the end of the year for Molnupiravir at the latest.
How many times do you have to practice saying the name of that?
I've been saying it so much, it's easy.
So these would be oral doses. You'd take a five pack of pills.
Yeah, it's eight pills twice. It's eight pills a day. It's 800 milligrams twice a day for 5 days.
Mm-hmm. And this is not cheap.
It's free.
Tell me about that.
So remember, we're in a pandemic, in case anybody forgets. And so the U.S. government is making this, will make this drug, like the monoclonals, available as part of our pandemic response.
How are these different from the monoclonal antibodies, which I understand have been given intravenously to patients sort of at the first sign of disease?
So again, it's this gets back to the whole issue of the emergency use authorization. The monoclonal antibodies were first approved in people with risk factors for disease progression. Those are well known: obesity, diabetes, age. These people tend to progress rapidly, get sick, get in the hospital, get on a ventilator, die. And the goal is to get them on those quickly. So the challenge with the monoclonals all along is they've had to be infused. So you had to have a place in a hospital or a facility where you could take people with coronavirus disease and hook them up to a system to infuse the antibody. Most infusion centers are dedicated to people who have cancer or some other horrible other disease that also is then associated with immunosuppression. So that's not a good mix. People who are immunosuppressed with people with coronavirus disease. So the monoclonals had to be infused, now have to be injected. There's the Regeneron antibodies can be injected. They specifically target the outer coat or the spike protein of the virus. So that would be the third target. And so when we think about drugs, if we consider antibodies a drug, we have drugs in the form of the antibodies that target the binding site of the virus, so it can prevents the virus from entering the cells. We have the polymerase inhibitors, and we have the protease inhibitors. But that's why we include the antibodies in this story, is because they could formally be viewed as a drug.
So the success of this Merck trial means this is moving very quickly. How do you think that this will affect the trajectory of the pandemic, having medications to treat?
Well, the goal is to keep people from progressing into the hospital and dying. So what we can do is, through the process of setting up places where people would go who are symptomatic, to go get tested, have a rapid test. This is a hypothetical now about how we would deliver these. You would then get a prescription, get your pills, and start taking them. And the goal then is to prevent some fraction of the people you treat with the pills from progressing. Now, the antibodies are in the 80 to 90% protective of preventing people from progressing. The Merck data, as reported in their press release, was about 50%. So the advantage of the pills is they're a lot easier to access. So you can treat more people quickly than you can with monoclonals. So if you think about what you could do with pills, you could, with a sufficient supply, you could really have a huge impact on hospitalization and death.
Is there any concern that having an effective treatment would maybe prevent people from getting vaccinated?
No, I think it has to be, from a public health perspective, you have to have both. Well, we already have governors in certain red states that are promoting antibodies over vaccination. So that has already occurred. And so there is a concern there. You know, that is just something public health is going to always need to deal with. You know, why somebody would take a pill and not a vaccine is probably the a story that somebody's PhD thesis will tell in terms of sociology or psychology in the future. But, you know, the goal in public health is to give, is to have choices and to have different tools in our toolbox, so we can deal with whatever comes at us. So with a vaccine, we prevent infection and disease. With monoclonals, we can prevent progression. With pills, now Molnupiravir is the first of the pills to come along. Hopefully over the next year or so, we will build out a deeper bench, to use a sports analogy, so we can have more choices there as well for people to use. Mm-hmm.
So I actually got the flu in early 2020, and I got to patient first a little too late to take Tamiflu, the antiviral for flu. But I was, you know, everything turned out okay, right? I got better and all of that. I know that there's a concern with COVID, that there's this long COVID situation. So I'm wondering if, you know, if I got there on day four, I'd still say, yes, I really want to take this Merck pill.
So we try to get people to start the pills within 5 days. You know, that's the way the trial was set up. The trial was to get people started on the Molnupiravir within 5 days of symptoms. So going forward, as part of the EUA process, the FDA will give us guidelines on how these medicines are to be used. And so what we'll do, so then we'll follow that. And, you know, if you're within that range, you will, by all rights, do better. you raise an important point, and this is a long-term question. Remember, we've only had coronavirus disease in this country for, you know, we're coming up on 2 years. So we really don't, we will not know for a while whether the use of these medications and the antibodies actually prevents long COVID. But that is a fundamental question that we fully intend to answer through these studies and other studies, you know, because that's a big deal. If the pills prevent, you know, help you convalesce quicker and also then prevent long COVID, that is a game changer as well. But again, we're not even close to answering that question yet, because people have been only taking these pills for a relatively short period of time.
What do you think we will see next?
Well, what we know is that there's a protease inhibitor that's in clinical trial from Pfizer Corporation. That's another oral, and that should complete within either late this calendar year or early the next calendar year. And then there are other drugs in the pipeline that are also at different stages that are further back. So between now and June, July of 2022, we may have 3 or 4 that are either at the EUA stage or have at least reported out. Now, when I say the EUA stage, that means you have completed a trial, and then you don't know. The idea of completing a trial is you get an answer, but you could get an answer you don't want, like it didn't work. And so we always have to be prepared for that. So the goal is to get an answer. So we will have answers most likely on 3 by that time frame.
Are you surprised that these kinds of drugs have been developed as quickly as they have been?
No, not at all. So molnupiravir was first developed as an Ebola drug and was tested as an Ebola drug in the outbreak in Liberia back in 2016, 17? So this drug has been in development as a broad spectrum antiviral for 10 years, approximately 10 years. The other drugs are more coronavirus specific, and so those have come up a little quicker. But remember, for the first part of the epidemic here, we were testing repurposed drugs, and that didn't exactly work out so great. But through those experiments, we just determined how best to treat hospitalized patients using dexamethasone and remdesivir and other drugs that were amenable to use in the hospital. We have made progress in that regard.
And I imagine having an easily accessible drug that you can take soon after onset, that should really help us get to the end of this pandemic.
Exactly. So again, for HIV, let's use HIV as a model. And, you know, let's talk about the vision. For HIV, we currently use medicine to treat people, and they become people with HIV become completely virally suppressed, and they don't progress. They live normal, healthy lives. And in that state, they cannot transmit their virus. No virus, no transmission. U equals U. It's a really powerful message. We also use the drugs for post-exposure prophylaxis and also use medicines for pre-exposure prophylaxis. The same vision can be used here. With the right drugs, with the right safety profile, you could have medicines that if there was an exposure, you could start a post-exposure prophylaxis protocol. In fact, Merck is testing their drug in a post-exposure model now. And I think that's the goal and the vision everybody has, because we know how wonderful it is to have something simple like a Z-pack of pills that you can take quickly should you get exposed or start getting the sniffles.
Dr. Carl Dieffenbach, thank you so much for joining me.
It's been a real pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmon. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outland. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holes Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.